Well, thank you so much, Olivia and Katherine. That was lovely. Welcome to worship here at the Monroe Congregational Church. It is a kind of rainy morning outside on Pierce Lawn, so our plan B is always to come indoors here in Wilton Hall, where we have plenty of ventilation and room to spread out. So we're grateful that you are able to be here with us, certainly in person, but virtually as well. I'd like to give an extra hearty welcome to the Bliotta family here for the baptism of their daughter, Lila. Jeffrey and Nicole, they're both school teachers. They were married here back in the meeting house a couple of years ago, and it's great to have you and your family back here with us. Welcome. It is our fifth installment of this summer's worship series, The Gospel Goes to Broadway. The Broadway musical we're going to look at today, if you hadn't have guessed, is Phantom of the Opera. So thank you so much to our Deacon of the Day, Susie, our scripture reader, Linda, our music director, Will, and to Katherine and Olivia for singing today. They will do so, as you saw, at a safe 20-foot distance from the congregation. If you are the parent of a school-age child, or you know one, please complete the faith formation survey that was sent to you this week by email so that Debbie and her team can better plan for the fall. And if you're tuning in from home, thanks for being here with us. We be sure to jump in on the Zoom coffee hour at 10:30 so we can check in with one another. I understand Don Whiteley has a birthday today. Hey, happy birthday to Don. And where a few months ago we might have sung to him, let's hum with our masks on a nice verse of happy birthday to Don. This peaceful place in the tumult to pray, to listen, to be with God, seeking to be refreshed and renewed so that we can continue to live and to love. Come, let us worship.
Join me in prayer. Lord, we pray that you would unlock our hearts that we might be fully alive to our true identities in you. Give us clear revelation to see ourselves the way you see us. Help us to stand in your truth against any and all attacks and guard our hearts with all vigilance. Help us to identify the lies and reveal to us any places where we are chained to the past in a negative way. Teach us to hear your voice. We thank you for our uniqueness and that we are made in your image. We want to understand and feel the deep feelings in your heart for us. We choose to believe the truth about how you see us. We thank you that we can hope in the future and believe in the good destiny that you have for us. You have a vision for our futures. Help us to feel and live fruitful lives now, and may they overflow with your love for others. Give us greater authority in our prayer life. We want to know you on a deeper level, and we don't want anything to hinder our relationship with you. Thank you for this new identity we have in you. Help us to live out this truth in our lives every day. In Jesus' name, amen.
And now, friends, I invite you to please take a moment and stand and share with one another from a safe distance, a sign of God's peace. Peace be with you.
Thank you.
Thank you, Olivia. That was lovely. And I can't think of a more beautiful song for this moment. When we are here gathered to welcome Lila Graceland Liotta into the nurture of the Christian Church. So at this time, I'd like to invite our deacon, Susie Cusio, to join me. And for Lila and her parents, Jeffrey and Nicole, and her sponsors, Christopher and Danielle, to come forward. In these times, friends, we have adapted the ways that we do baptisms here so that we are safer. Lila's parents and her sponsors will apply the water as we say the words, and we will all stay physically distanced. The liturgy which we will use can be found in today's bulletin, so please follow along with us. Members and friends in Christ, we gather to celebrate the gift of grace in the sacrament of baptism. There is one body and one spirit. There is one hope in God's call to us. There is one Lord, one faith, one baptism, one God, and creator of us all. The sacrament of baptism is an active, outward, and visible sign of the grace of God, inasmuch as the promise of the gospel is not only to us, but to our children. Baptism with water and the Holy Spirit is the mark of their acceptance into the care of Christ's church, the sign and seal of their participation in God's forgiveness, and the beginning of their growth into full Christian faith and discipleship.
Nicole and Jeffrey, do you desire to have your child baptized into the faith and family of Jesus Christ? If so, please say, we do.
We do.
Do you promise by the grace of God to walk in the ways of Jesus Christ, showing love and justice as best you can? If so, please say, we do.
We do.
Jeffrey and Nicole, Christopher and Danielle, do you promise to grow with Lila in the Christian faith, to guide her in the life of prayer, and to offer her the nurture of the Christian church? If so, please say, we promise with God's help.
We promise with God's help.
Congregation, please stand and offer your support. Jesus Christ calls us to make disciples of all nations and to offer them the gift of grace in baptism. Do you, who witness and celebrate this sacrament, promise your love, support, and care to Layla as she lives and grows in Christ?
We promise our love, support, and care.
Please be seated.
Let us unite with the church in all times and places in confessing our faith in the triune God. Do you believe in God?
I believe in God.
Do you believe in Jesus Christ?
I believe in Jesus Christ.
Do you believe in the Holy Spirit?
I believe in the Holy Spirit.
Let us pray. God, we pray that you add the blessing of the Holy Spirit to this water, gracious God. By your Holy Spirit, save those who confess the name of Jesus Christ, that sin may have no power over them. Create new life in the one baptized today, that she may rise in Christ. Glory to you, eternal God, the one who was and is and shall always be, world without end. Amen. Nicole and Jeffrey, Danielle and Christopher, I invite you to step forward and please dip your fingers in the water and repeat after me as you make the sign of the cross on this precious child's forehead. Lila Graceland Liotta. We baptize you in the name of the Father.
We baptize you in the name of the Father.
And of the Son. And of the Holy Spirit. One God, Mother of us all. The Holy Spirit be upon you, Lila, disciple of Christ, member of the Church Universal. You have filled the world with joy by giving us the gift of Jesus. Bless this newly baptized child. May Layla be filled with joy. May she never be afraid to confess a personal faith in you. Bless her parents, Jeffrey and Nicole, and her sponsors, Christopher and Danielle. May they always show their gratitude for the life you have given them by loving and caring for this and all children. Bless this congregation, your faithful people. Unite us in the peace of Christ that passes all understanding. Amen. Now, church, may I introduce you to your new little sister in the family of Christ, Lila Grayson. Friends, we now turn our hearts to prayer for our congregation, for our community, for our world. Please, will you look on with me to the prayer concerns as listed in this morning's bulletin. I'd like to add prayers for our teachers and students, parents and staff, as they prepare for a new and more complex school year. May they have patience and strength and resilience. We pray for Julia's mother, Mary, who is recovering from a fall. For Scott, on the loss of his mother, Shirley. Are there any other concerns to be added this morning, friends? Let us pray. God of community, we open our hearts, our minds, our very beings to your presence. Together with the rest of your global community, we come before you in thanksgiving. We look to the world around us and we see the wonders of creation. Flashing lightning, rolling thunder. The beautiful colors in the sky at sunrise and sunset, the twinkling eyes of the people we meet. And loving God, on this day as in every day, we join with our neighbors near and far to share our concerns and our struggles, remembering all the reasons people struggle in life, people who need a bit of hope. We share our prayers for help. We pray with and for those who wrestle with illness of body or mind or spirit. Those who worry about next month's rent or last month's power bill or today's groceries. Those who live with the threat of violence. Those who are dealing with the aftermath of natural disasters. Those who stare into the reality of grief and loss. Those who feel lost, isolated, and alone. And with the rest of your beloved children, we share gratitude for what we have received. For family and friends and loved ones who share our lives. For food on our tables and a roof over our heads. For the laughter of children and the wisdom of elders, and vice versa. These things we pray in the name of Jesus, our teacher and guide, our rock and redeemer. And we join with Christians across the years and across the globe, sharing words he once taught his closest friends, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Friends, you and I have received so much from God. Food for our bodies and our souls. Forgiveness to heal our spirits and our lives. So we come to this moment in worship when we give thanks and we give back to God a portion of what we've received to express our own amazement at everything God is doing in our lives. Our offering plate today may be found on the hospitality table. Our hope is that if you are planning on giving an offering today, you'll do so either at the table or online at www.mcc-ucc/donate. So let us gather our gifts together and offer them to God in gratitude and in praise.
Today is from Matthew 23, verses 1 through 12 and 23. Then Jesus said to the crowds and to his disciples, "The scribes and the Pharisees sit on Moses' seat. Therefore, do whatever they teach you and follow it. But do not do as they do, for they do not practice what they teach. They tie up heavy burdens, hard to bear, excuse me, and lay them on the shoulders of others. But they themselves are unwilling to lift a finger to move them. They do all their deeds to be seen by others, for they make their phylacteries broad and their fringes long. They love to have a place of honor at banquets and the best seats in the synagogues, and to be greeted with respect in the marketplaces, and to have people call them rabbi. But you are not to be called rabbi, for you have one teacher, and you are all students. And call no one your father on earth, for you have one father, the one in heaven. Nor are you to be called instructors, for you have one instructor, the Messiah. The greatest among you will be your servant. All who exalt themselves will be humbled, and all who humble themselves will be exalted. Woe to you, scribes and Pharisees, hypocrites, for you tithe mint, dill, and cumin, and have neglected the weightier matters of the law, justice and mercy and faith. May God add his blessing to the readings we hear today.
Thank you so much, Linda. So, Phantom of the Opera, it's the most successful entertainment product in history. Did you know that? Yeah, grossing over $6 billion worldwide. It's also the longest running musical in the history of Broadway, with over 10,000 shows, far surpassing all others, even Cats. But the success of the musical would have astounded Gaston Leroux, who is the writer of the 1910 French novel of the same name, because his book didn't sell very well. Leroux based his novel on some mysterious events that really happened in the Paris Opera House, which is a real place. Critics didn't give the book very good reviews. Phantom's central plot revolves around a beautiful soprano, Christine Daae, who becomes the obsession of a mysterious, disfigured musical genius living in the subterranean lair beneath the Paris Opera House. In Leroux's original novel, the Phantom's name is Eric. And as you may already know, Eric was born with deformed facial features. His father left the family even before seeing the child. And Eric's mother abused him. When he was a boy, he ran away, joined a bunch of travelers, carnival folk. He made his living as an attraction in freak shows, we learn. While living in this carnival, he also became an expert magician, illusionist, and of course, an expert magician. As he gets older, Eric becomes more and more bitter and angry, and he starts to wear a mask to cover half of his face, his appearance. Now, before we go any further, I need to acknowledge the elephant among us. As we consider this particular musical during a global pandemic, the masks that we wear today in public are necessary for the health and the welfare of one another. It would be easier for all of us to think of them as merely a symbol had I chosen to celebrate Phantom last summer. But no, I chose this summer. So instead, here we are with this baggage of mask wearing that we all carry today. And I'm not quite sure what to do with all of that except acknowledge it and encourage you to continue to wear your mask until this public health crisis is abated. In today's gospel reading, the writer of the Gospel of Matthew says that Jesus was upset with the scribes and the Pharisees, the religious folk of the time. He calls them hypocrites. Now, it's interesting that the Greek word for hypocrite means actor, one who wears a mask. Jesus is upset because they are pretending to be something they are not. They are not, we learn, being authentic. And you know, it can be really challenging for each of us to be our authentic selves. It's really easy for us to pretend to be something that we're not. We can become so good at it that it becomes a habit. We may want to be authentic, but the fear of being real can creep in. Fear of rejection, abandonment, fear of messing up or losing the ones we love, we try to protect ourselves. And we cover up. We move away from being who we really are. But I believe one of the keys to living a fulfilling, authentic life is being yourself. And to live authentically, it's important to identify and experience those places of pain and struggle in our lives, those places in our past where we got hurt and where we struggled so intensely that it still affects the way we are living out our lives in the here and the now. In the book of Acts, we read that Paul was on his way to Damascus, breathing threats of murder. His mission was to find anyone who was a follower of this upstart named Jesus so he could capture them and bring them back to Jerusalem for trial. He was a man who was ruled by anger and meanness of spirit. But the story that Paul would later tell is that he was interrupted on the way by a dramatic experience. A power swept over him with a light that was so bright it blinded him. And he fell to the ground and he heard a voice say, "Saul, why are you persecuting me?" This was the defining moment in Paul's life. With his whole self, he got in touch with his anger. He got in touch with his rage, with his confusion. And as much as that can hurt, it's the most important thing that can happen to a person, because it's at that moment when we learn to face our own human limitations. Now, there's a simple thing we can do, and it's not easy, but it's part of the life and growth. It's learn to tell your story, to share who you really are. Know that the story you tell today will be different from the one you told 10 years ago, because you learn to get deeper inside and closer to the place of struggle. And when you do that, the story will change. You will understand yourself better. And choose wisely who you share your pain and your struggle with. Don't spill it all over the place to many different people. This is holy stuff we're talking about, sacred stuff. Tell your story to someone who's going to understand you, who's going to care and affirm you. Let it be someone who will ask good questions to help you go deeper. Some find it helpful, especially these days, to talk to a therapist, someone who is trained to know how the mind works, how to get it to work better, how to deal with emotions. When we go to a therapist, we are in effect saying, "Help me tell my story so that I can be healed." Sometimes we're led to share parts of our stories with people we don't know very well. Maybe that's the Holy Spirit at work. When Clark and I became therapeutic foster parents 3 years ago, we signed on with this agency who manages the case of special needs kids. Those who are categorized as academically, socially, medically, emotionally complex. So he and I were required to attend regular training in how to meet their needs. And in one of those sessions, I sat down next to a woman named Thelma. She had not only raised over 30 special needs foster children, but she had adopted, at last count, a baker's dozen. So Thelma is a therapeutic foster care superhero. Normally in these trainings, I keep to myself because I figure there's so many others in the room who know so much more than I do. But something prompted me during break to share with Thelma my deep disappointment at not being able to reach our latest foster child, who had been removed from our care. So I shared my story with her, including all the raw details, my deep frustration with the system, how I felt about my own limitations and my shortcomings, and how this failure with a young man who I had come to love like my own son made me want to quit and move on. I was broken. But Thelma, God bless her, she heard me patiently and non-judgmentally. She then shared some stories of her own to help me know that I wasn't alone. And I left that training with a new sense of hope. And Thelma's cell number with an invitation to call whenever I needed to talk. It was a good lesson for me because it helped me realize that this special connection would never have happened if I hadn't had the courage to say something real about my struggle. When we're able to get in touch with those places of pain in our lives, it helps us to have more empathy for other people. When we're in touch with our own brokenness, we have more compassion for the people, which motivates us to take action and to serve. And that leads us, I think, to becoming more faithful followers of Christ, more effective instruments of healing and compassion. And here's the key to it all. Deep down, what every single one of us desires more than anything is to be loved and accepted unconditionally by this power, this force, this mystery we call God, this one who created us. And that's one reason why the church community is so important, so that we can experience and tell each other over and over again the life-saving message that God loves us. Because each one of us has different tapes running in our mind. The first time that Christine saw Eric without his mask, she was horrified. But towards the end of the show, there's this moment when she looks at him again without his mask, and she's able to have this great compassion and empathy. Christine kisses Eric on the forehead. And in the book, we learn that Eric had never been kissed before in his entire life, not even by his mother. After Eric experiences this moment of grace, he frees the captured Christine and her lover, Raul. He lets them go. The power of unconditional love is transforming, liberating, life-giving. So let us trust God and God's love for us so we can take down our metaphorical masks so that we can be liberated, so that we can experience the fullness of life, so that we can move from the darkness into the light. Amen. Friends, as worship draws now to a close, the weak and the world await. Go out into this world to live and love unconditionally. Go knowing that God is with you each and every moment of each and every day. Be blessed and be a blessing. Amen.